Okay, greetings everyone. This is Gerard, aka OG, Mr. Vegas the Sun, representing the Purple One, the Continental, the Prince of Wannabes. Okay, what I got for you is that, you know, I've been wanting to post about Michael Jackson, you know, how I've kind of traveled in a circle with him a little bit. So, but before I do, I want you to hear something. You know, I spoke about my brother who is a, you know, there are a lot of DJs or mix masters who are not as well known as a Kid Capri or Grandmaster Flash or, you know, Dougie Fresh or a lot of the other, you know, mix masters. Well, my brother has always been one, and he has, I always admired him because he was always able to get the music industry, you know, to send him, you know, advanced music or, you know, so it was always amazing to me how he was able to get stuff. And it was funny because when Michael Jackson had did his last album project while he was alive, my brother was able to get an advanced copy of those tracks. And this was the time when I was working on New York State's first Rainbow Festival with Randy Jones of the Village People. You know, we had an event, and it was also a listening party for Michael Jackson's new release project. But then he passed away. And that project got scratched. And although we still played the music that we had, but they changed the tracks on that song, on that project. And he was able to get that. And I had probably one of the very few advanced, because of my brother, advanced copies of that music. But this is what he mixed. And before I talk about him, I want you to listen to this. This is my brother's mix.
Gathered in love vigils to celebrate the life of a man that taught the world how to love. People may be wondering why there's such an emotional outburst, but you would have to understand the journey of Michael.
That's Reverend Dr.
Understand what he meant to all of us.
If you haven't picked up on it yet, this is the eulogy of Michael Jackson's funeral. And it was it was Reverend Dr. Al Sharpton spoke, so you'll hear a speech.
These that sit here as the Jackson family, a mother and father of nine children, that rose from a working class family in Gary, Indiana. They had nothing but a dream. No one believed in those days that these kind of dreams could come true. But they kept on believing, and Michael never let the world turn him around from his dreams. I first met Michael around 1970, Black Expo, Chicago, Illinois, Reverend Jesse Jackson, who stood by his family till now. And from that day, as a cute kid, to this moment, he never gave up dreams. It was that dream that changed culture all over the world. When Michael started, it was a different world. But because Michael kept going, because he didn't accept limitations, because he refused to let people decide his boundaries, he opened up the whole world. In the music world, he put on one glove for pulled his pants up and broke down the color curtain where now our videos are shown and magazines put us on the cover. It was Michael Jackson that brought blacks and whites and Asians and Latinos together. It was Michael Jackson that made us say we are the world and feed the hungry long before Live Aid. Because Michael Jackson kept going, he created a comfort level where people that felt they were separate became interconnected with his music. And it was that comfort level that kids from Japan and Ghana and France and Iowa and Pennsylvania got comfortable enough with each other to later it wasn't strange to us to watch Oprah on television. It wasn't strange to watch Tiger Woods golf. Those young kids grew up from being teenage, comfortable fans of Michael, to being 40 years old and being comfortable to vote for a person of color to be the president of the United States of America. Michael did that. Michael made us love each other. Michael taught us to stand with each other. There are those that like to dig around mess, but millions around the world, we're gonna uphold his message. It's not about mess, it's about his love message. As you climb up steep mountains, sometimes you scar your knee. Sometimes you break your skin, but don't focus on the scars. Focus on the journey. Michael Beater, Michael rose to the top. He outsang his cynics. He outdanced his doubters. He outperformed the pessimists. Every time he got knocked down, he got back up. Every time you counted him out, he came back in. Michael never stopped. Michael never stopped. Michael never stopped.
I'm going to stop right there because I was in Las Vegas and I had my scooter. And I had met a girl. I'm always about this girl. I met a girl, and her and I were, you know, leaving the motel, and she was. I was playing this because I have, you know, speakers. I had a speaker on my bike, and she was listening to it. And then when this part came on, said, Michael never stop. Michael never stop. Michael never stop. And she was just yelling it. And I was like touched because the music had touched her so much. Listen to the eulogy. Michael never stop. Michael. It was just amazing. Yes, can I help you? What is it? What do you want? What? You want to come in? You want to say hello? Nope. Okay. But it was interesting that it had moved her that much.
I want to thank to Mrs. Jackson and Joe Jackson, his sisters and brothers. We thank you for giving us someone that taught us love, someone that taught us hope. We want to thank you because we know it was your dream too. And we know that your heart is broken.
What do you want?
I know you have some comfort from the letter from the President of the United States and Nelson Mandela, but this was your child. This was your brother. This was your cousin. Nothing will fill your heart's loss. But I hope the love that people have shown will make you know he didn't live in vain. And I want his three children to know.
There's nothing strange about your daddy. It was strange what your daddy had to deal with.
But he dealt with it
anyway. We'll be right back.
So some came today, Mrs. Jackson, to say goodbye to Michael. I came to say thank you. Thank you because you never stopped. Thank you because you never gave up. Thank you because you never gave out. Thank you because you tore down our divisions. Thank you because you eradicated barriers. Thank you because you gave us hope. Thank you, Michael.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Michael.
I'm not afraid to
Thank you. for you're always in my heart.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that. That was my brother's mix of the eulogy from Michael Jackson's funeral. Let me say this before I go any further with Michael Jackson. I have always and still maintain to be a Jackson 5 fan. I love the Jackson 5s. I love the Jacksons. You know, when Michael started doing his own thing, you know, by that time I was hooked in Prince, you know. I was with a young lady and she taught me, I was with this girl. I was with this girl and she taught me the importance of reading the lyrics that artists wrote. And the one that we studied more than anything else was Prince, you know. So we studied his whole catalog. We were all about Prince. You know, so, you know, I never really followed Michael Jackson. In fact, it wasn't until I got to Cebu, Philippines, when I saw Remember the Time video, actually with what's his name? Johnson, what was his name? The basketball player. And a few other people who were in it. Magic Johnson. Excuse me, I'm in the G hours. I've been up since 11 and right now it's going on like about 3 or 4. And, you know, I remember when the album came out, my brother, of course, had an advanced copy of it. And we were listening in the car with the same girl who I used to listen to Prince, who taught me on Prince. And we were listening to it. And when I heard Remember the Time, I said, that's the song that's going to be the big hit off of this thing. Now, I've always had the uncanny ability to be able to pick winners from songs. You know, when I hear something, I knew it was going to be a hit. Just like when Prince did a song, what song he did? What's the Matter with Your Life? Pop Life. When he did Pop Life and the bell rung, ding, at that time I used to always record music off the radio. You know, so you had to be careful not to get the DJ in there or the commercial in there or what have you. So. But when it said ding, something told me don't stop the recording. And then the song picked up again. I knew it. So it was that sixth sense about music that I've always had. So I was never really a Michael Jackson fan. In fact, I'm listening to a lot of his music now for the very first time. You know, I want to say that because this way you can understand where I'm coming from. With Michael Jackson. It was funny because when he passed away, some of my work that I've done with him. In fact, the footage that you see him speaking from the National Action Network when he started talking about how the media started turning against him and how everyone started turning against him because they were jealous of him you know, owning the Beatles catalog. How he had passed Elvis Presley's record and all this other stuff, and then they start calling him Freak, and then after the Thriller album, then they start calling him all these names and all this stuff or what have you. He slept the Albert Chamber. Well, this is, I don't know if you can see it, I'm going to try to put it up here. This is a shot, this is Johnny Cochran, Al Sharpton, and Michael Jackson when he spoke before that panel there at the National Action Network complaining about Sony Records because he felt Sony Records was not putting the muscle behind he had known to have put behind him in the music industry when he was promoting a project. And he felt that the reason they weren't doing it because they didn't want it to be a success because Michael had put up so much collateral to ensure the success of the album, of the project, because, you know, Michael Jackson was Michael Jackson. But come to find out that Sony didn't. Sony had dragged his feet about it, and Michael was very disappointed in that. So I just wanted to point that out. I have covered Michael Jackson, the Jackson 5s. I photographed them. I have a shot of Janet Jackson, Michael Jackson, Al Sharpton, Mr. James Brown, Frank McRae. Some of you have seen it. And some of you have seen my picture of Michael Jackson sitting behind Reverend Dr. Al Sharpton's desk where that shot came from and where that footage came from of him talking about how Sony was not, or when the world turned against him, I guess. So I call him child molest and all that stuff. And I also broadcasted during his last trial. I was on the radio. I broadcast 18 weeks of Do You Swear to Talk About the Jacksons, the whole Jacksons, and nothing but the Jacksons, so help you God. And it was each week I talked about the progression of the case, the witnesses. I had calling guests, Sarah Rea, who was the background dancer for The Godfather, so Mr. James Brown, Sly from Sly, Slick, and Wicked, who was with Joe Jackson, who was CEO. Joe Jackson was CEO of his company, and a number of other people who were called in. Michael Harding, who is Reverend Al Sharpton's legal counsel, who we spoke about. Michael Jackson having the propensity. That was the law that they were trying, they were debating over if he had the propensity to commit this crime. So at that time, what's the name? Aphrodite. Aphrodite Jones was also was one of the people outspoken against Michael Jackson, as well as Nancy Grace, who was speaking out against Michael Jackson. But anyway, my show, 18 Weeks of Do You Swear to Talk About the Jacksons, the whole Jacksons, and nothing but the Jacksons, so help you God. It was about each member of the Jackson family who I profiled, because each one of them had their own success in the music industry, you know. So I talked a lot about each one, you know. And it's funny because, you know, a lot of people want to talk about Joe Jackson, how tough. How heavy-handed he was about raising his kids, you know, the disciplinarian of how he raised his kids. And, you know, it's funny because, if me personally, beat my ass and make me a millionaire, you know, because that's how I feel he did. But you got to hand it to him, because out of all the children he had, you never heard of one of them being caught coming out of a crack house. You never heard any of them being caught in a high-speed chase. You never heard any of them, you know, doing anything that would that has known to happen with child celebrities or entertainers, you know, who've been in the business since they were kids. And in a way, I don't blame Michael for having children around him, for the simple reason because, you know, if you watch a lot, you know, his older brothers, you know, put him down and didn't want him to hang out with them because they were in the girls and Michael was too young at that time or whatever. So they always made fun of Michael and what have you. So as he got older, I guess the only people who he could trust around him were children, you know, and I understand that, you know, because, you know, children are...